And so Dr. Brand, who is a medical doctor, found ways that I would never have thought of that show the spiritual parallel, how blood is the living connection to the source of life, and then blood is also a cleansing agent.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive. Today on Focus on the Family, we're going to explore what is, to many, a very familiar passage from the Bible in the Old Testament book of Psalms, Psalm 139, which was written as a response to God expressing wonder at his creativity. David wrote, "For you formed my inward parts, you knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and my soul knows it very well." Thanks for joining us today. Your host is Focus President and author Jim Daly. I'm John Fuller.
John, those are familiar words that often are heard in the church, but maybe not fully understood. And we are going to delve into that today with one of the world's greatest Christian authors, Philip Yancey. And I'm wondering how many of us know what that phrase, fearfully and wonderfully made, really means. And to be honest, most of us don't, if we're honest with ourselves. But more than 30 years ago, two men wrote a pair of landmark books, Fearfully and Wonderfully Made, and In His Image. They revealed some of the most profound wonders of the human body and how these wonders can also be reflected in the body of Christ.
Yeah, it's a wonderful concept. And one of those men, Dr. Paul Brand, was a world-renowned orthopedic surgeon and missionary doctor who had spent a great deal of his career caring for leprosy patients in India and also in the U.S. Dr. Paul Brand passed away in 2003. The other author is, as you said, well-known, very well-known, Philip Yancey, and he's been here on the broadcast before. He's written at least 25 books, including Disappointment with God, Where is God When It Hurts, The Jesus I Never Knew, and What's So Amazing About Grace?
Well, Philip, the most wonderful author, welcome back to Focus on the Family.
Thank you very much.
That's amazing, though. You have had an amazing career communicating through the written word. Do you ever step back and think, wow, Lord, thank you for this ride?
I do indeed. And it's funny because you've done writing yourself, and it's an isolating, paranoia-producing act. You know, you do it in isolation. You have no idea whether anybody's going to read it, whether it's even going to become a book. And then years later, somebody will come up to you and say, I read this book, and this is how it affected my life. So the longer I live, the more of that I get, that kind of retrospective view. But it's also hard work.
No, it is. And it is so rewarding when people come up and express how you helped shape their thinking or their spiritual journey.
Right.
It's a very humbling thing, really. And profound. Let's start with Genesis 1, where God decided to make mankind in his image. I use this so often with people, even people that don't agree with us about eternal life. They're not Christian. I'll talk to them about being made in the image of God. They always are intrigued by that. They don't necessarily agree with it. But what's the power in that statement? What are you seeing when that great phrase is used, made in the image of God?
God is a spirit, and you can't take somebody, say a spiritual searcher, and say, "Let me show you God." You know, here he is. Here's what he's like. And we are not spirits. We have a spiritual part, but we are people of flesh, and we have bodies around us. And being in the image of God is a way of showing the rest of the world what God is like, making God visible. I was with a wonderful woman in South Africa one time who had a prison ministry, and it had enormous effect on the prison. It went from one of the most violent prisons in Africa to one where things were calm. There were only two acts of violence the next year. And I said to her, "What was your secret?" And she said, "Well, Philip, God was already there in that Polesmore prison. I just had to make him visible."
Wow.
And that's what we're called to do. So that when somebody's made in your image, you say, "Oh, that reminds me. He's a spitting image of his dad, you know? Because when I look at him, his nose, his ears, or whatever, they remind me of his dad."
Yeah, right.
And I think that's what we followers of Jesus are supposed to do. So that when people look at us, they say, "Oh, that's unusual, caring for those kind of people. Most people want to ignore them. Most people are interested in climbing the ladder, and they're interested in kind of climbing down the ladder and caring for the outcast, as Jesus did. That is what Jesus is like. That's what God is like, and we are to reflect that image, to make God visible.
Philip, you made a statement in the book, and it said, all of us are like mirrors with the potential to summon up in the others the spark of God-likeness in the human spirit. I mean, that's one of those things, and I think it's why so many people love your writing. You get it, but it even goes deeper. Explain that to me.
Yes, that actually came from an experience that Dr. Brand had. Dr. Brand was a British surgeon. He was being trained during the Blitz of London during World War II, which is a great time to be trained in medicine, but not a good time to be living in London.
Right.
And the heroes, the true heroes of Britain were RAF fighters, because every day these German bombers would come over and drop bombs. 3,000 people a day were dying. Think of that, a World Trade Center catastrophe
every day
for a couple months there. And it looked like they were just going to completely destroy the city. Well, then these heroic Air Force guys, Royal Air Force, got in their little Spitfires, and they took on these bombers, and eventually Hitler had to call off the bombing campaign. So these were heroic guys. Well, the Spitfire had one flaw, and that was the gasoline tube went from the propeller in the front through the cockpit back to the fuel tank. You know,
so the fuel line ran by the pilot.
Right by it. So if they got hit, the entire cockpit would explode. Now, they had an ejection seat, but it was too late. By the time the cockpit exploded, you know, they're burned beyond recognition. And Dr. Brand, in his rotation, would visit some of these airmen. And here are these guys. They're top of their class. They're these handsome figures. People on the street, you know, salute them. Little kids want to be like them. And now they look like Quasimodo, you know.
Right.
Their faces are all twisted and burned. And one of them said to him, the people that we love, who love us, become our mirrors. We'll lie here, and I know you doctors will do everything that you can to make us look as normal as possible, but we know, you know, what you do won't restore the person that we are. And before we go out and face that world, and he said, my fiance became my mirror, so that when I looked at her, when I look in the mirror, I see this misshapen, charred face. When I look at her, I see somebody who loves me. And Dr. Brand goes on to say, we can be that mirror for other people. There are a lot of people around us who don't feel beautiful, you know, who feel like losers, who are deformed or just depressed, discouraged. And we can be the mirror that reflects back to them, there is something of beauty and worth in you. That's what we can do as Christians.
And in so many ways, you're illustrating the call of Christ in us. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what the Lord did, right? He met with the malformed, whether it was physical, emotional, spiritual.
Yeah.
He encountered them and restored them.
It could be transforming, and it doesn't have to be a physical defect. Think of the story of Zacchaeus. He was just a disliked person, despised person in the community because he was a tax collector working for the occupying Romans, and nobody would have anything to do with him. And he climbed a tree. When you're in Sunday school, you hear a wee little man named Zacchaeus. I think he climbed a tree because he was scared of the townspeople.
The mob.
Yeah, he wanted to be in a safe place. So he's up there, and Jesus stops the procession and says, Zacchaeus, I'd like to come to your house for dinner tonight. He became that mirror. You know, nobody had treated Zacchaeus like that before. And it transformed him. That night, he's giving away, anybody I've cheated, I'll restore four times what I cheated them of.
Right. An amazing turnaround.
Yeah, all in one night.
Again, it takes interaction. It takes relationship. In that regard, Philip, during this past COVID pandemic, we restricted, you know, for medical reasons, interaction with people. And you made the statement, I believe, that one of the most meaningful things we can do as human beings is to hug and to touch and to interact with one another. Why do you believe that touch is so essential to the expression of God's love?
Hmm. I find it interesting, if you look at Jesus' miracles, he didn't wave a magic wand, you know? He didn't stand right in front of a group and say, okay, all of you with COVID-19 over on the left, all of you who are having trouble walking over on the right, and I'll take care of you. He didn't do that. It was individual. It was one by one. It was touch. Dr. Brand worked with leprosy patients, and in those days, in the 1950s when he was started, it was still a very feared disease. And he would tell stories of a patient who would come often walking because they would be kicked off a bus. People were so afraid of leprosy. And he told the story of one man who showed up at his house, and he invited him up to the porch. And he was telling a story, and Dr. Brand reached over and touched his shoulder, and the patient just started crying. And he said, did I say something to offend you? And he said, no, it's just that in many years, no one has ever touched me.
Think of that.
Yeah. And from birth on, you know, these studies of babies who aren't touched, they shrivel up. They don't really develop as they should mentally in other
right.
ways. And that's been proven. Touch is maybe our most reliable sense. If you think back, Thomas, the disciple, you know, he was doubting yeah. until Jesus said, touch me, you know,
right.
what do you want? What proof do you need? And Thomas, that's the only time when in the New Testament, somebody called Jesus God, my Lord and my God, Thomas said. Touch was the decisive thing. It was the proof. Oh, you really are the Messiah, the wounded Messiah.
It's interesting. I hadn't thought about it in this way, but you think of touch, it's probably the greatest act of intimacy.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not talking in a sexual context. Of course, that's true. But you see someone, and you see someone.
Right.
But when you touch someone, a hand on the shoulder, a hug, something like that, it's a very intimate
yes.
act on the part of human beings.
And that's one of the great tragedies of COVID-19, too. I interviewed a chaplain who works in Denver at a memory facility with dementia and Alzheimer's.
Mm.
And for a year, it was under lockdown where nobody was allowed in. So these patients were already confused, and they're used to having their relatives come and hug them and touch them, and now they just stop, and they can't really understand it when you explain to them, well, we have this disease going on, and,
right.
and they're not allowed in anymore, and how difficult it is for these people, and you hear the stories of people who die in isolation, nobody around them. And she was a chaplain. She was one of them who would be with those people, and sometimes she would just reach out and touch them because we need that. That's part of humanity.
Oh, we do. We do.
This is Focused on the Family with Jim Daly, and today we're talking with Philip Yancey, who, along with the late Dr. Paul Brand, has written a terrific resource. It's Fearfully and Wonderfully. The subtitle is The Marvel of Bearing God's Image, and this is an updated and combined edition of two great classics. We do have that here at Focus on the Family. Click the link there on your screen or give us a call, 800, the letter A and the word family.
Philip, I do want to kind of paint the picture of how you and Dr. Brand worked together, because that was, rather interesting that you spent 10 years together. I'm sure that was off and on, but describe how you connected. And
sure. My very first book is a book called Where Is God When It Hurts? And I was spending a lot of time in libraries reading books on the problem of pain, the curse of pain, God's one mistake, you know, books with titles like that. And my wife was working at a medical supply house that would ship medicines to mission hospitals. And she came across a little booklet, actually based on a speech Dr. Paul Brand had given, called The Gift of Pain.
Mm.
And I had never heard anybody call it a gift before, and
right.
I had never thought of pain as a gift before.
Right.
So I found out he was now in Louisiana at a hospital, public health service hospital, treating leprosy. And I called him up out of the blue and said, could I come interview you about pain? He said, I don't know, I'm kind of busy. I said, well, I'll just hang out in the hallway, and if you have a lunch hour or something like that, I've got a lot of questions.
You should have said, I'll make it painful for you.
Yeah, right. I hope it wasn't, but we were kind of an odd couple. I was in my 20s. My hair was wild and crazy. It was this right after the 60s. And here was this distinguished silver-haired British surgeon who had spent a third of his life in Britain and a third of his life in India. But he became like a father figure to me. And I could take him all my questions and all my doubts. He was so important to my forming my faith, really,
yeah.
Because I had come from an unhealthy church background. And here I saw a person who was made better in every way by his faith. He was a brilliant surgeon. He had gotten, you know, being awarded the Commander of the British Empire Award from the Queen, gotten all these medical awards, but he was a humble, gracious, he made God visible for me.
Yeah.
And over the years, we kept coming up with more material. That was back in I think the first book came out in 1979. And I did not want the legacy of Dr. Brand to disappear. Medicine has changed a lot in 40 years. They had just barely discovered DNA when we were first writing. And so I wanted to go back, and I took the best of two books, Fearfully and Wonderfully Made and In His Image, combined them and updated the science, updated the medicine, and just wanted to keep alive the memory and the example of Paul Brand.
Something you said I really have to punch there, because it just caught me when you said he was a man whose faith made him better.
Mm.
What a litmus test.
Yeah.
Isn't that the point? I mean, really, we should each reflect on that to say, does my faith make me a better person?
Right.
And if it's not, you may want to reconsider how you're displaying your faith.
Yeah. And when I go around, Jim, that's one of my concerns. Sitting in an airplane, I'll often ask, when I say the word Christian, what's the first thing that comes to mind? And often they'll say things, well, they'll say, oh, those are moral people or upright people. But sometimes they'll say they're bigots, they're self-righteous. You know, that's a condemnation, because we're, as Christians, we're not self-righteous. All of our righteousness comes from God. And if you find a person who really is that humble servant, but yet is using all of his gifts, as Dr. Brand did, for some of the lowliest people on the planet, you just stand back and say, oh, that's what Jesus was like in Philippians 2, you know? He turned down the prerogatives of Godhead and became one of us and washed our feet and was a servant. And if we can show that, then that's something that it cuts so much against the grain of a success, celebrity-oriented culture.
Yeah.
That it gets your attention. You say, oh, that's what God was like.
Let me get in to the book, specifically some of the systems of the body, which you and Dr. Brand talked about. It's so beautiful. So often, Philip, I'm feeling like God is making it so simple. Of course, the Word says you could look at His creation and see Him.
Mm.
And that's really the essence of what you've done here. Talk to us about the bone, the skeletal system, and what does it depict spiritually for us?
Mm. Well, Dr. Brand tells stories of people who are missing parts of their bone, and like a section of the bone has been removed because of cancer in an arm, and then nothing works the way it's supposed to anymore, because they're so intricately connected with muscles and tendons and all that, and they work on a fulcrum, a triangulation of different sinews and ligaments working together. You have to have a hard skeleton to hang on. Look at an octopus. An octopus just kind of squishes around.
Right.
Can't climb stairs. Can't do a lot of things. It takes an internal skeleton structure to allow us to do things like walking, or for a bird to fly. You need those hard bones. And it's easy to say, I'm a skier, for example. It's easier to say, a lot of people break their bones in skiing. If only God had made bones bigger and thicker and harder. Well, actually, they're beautifully proportioned. If God did that, there are a lot of things that we couldn't do. We wouldn't have the ability to do other athletics. I loved hearing Dr. Brand talk about the wonders of the human body. In fact, even the things that are a little bit repulsive to us. Anytime I would bring something up like vomiting, he would say, oh, what a wonderful thing, vomiting. Here you've got...
He doesn't have young children.
Yeah, these muscles and structures that are all designed to push food down, but when you have the wrong kind of food and you want to get rid of it, they find a way to reverse and do the opposite. And then sneezing, the same thing, coughing, diarrhea. Anything I would bring up, he'd say, oh, what a wonderful mechanism we have to protect the human body. And engineers, when they look at the human body, they think, I don't see how it could be improved. Doctors get used to it. Doctors assume that if you put two muscles back together, somehow the fibers will go like this and grow together. They assume that the heart will repair itself. I mean, that's just what organs do. Engineers look at that and say, how does that happen?
Right.
My robots can't repair themselves, and they're not nearly as smoothly functioning.
Yeah. Mm. You mentioned the spiritual parallel, I guess, is the best way to say it, with the bone structure, that when a bone breaks, you know, what it does, and you're describing that damage. Relay that to the spiritual parallel that you and Dr. Brand talked about in the book, that the skeletal system is like the core truth.
Right. Well, I would say probably the closest parallel would be the Ten Commandments. Those are the 10 things that God came up with for a society to work. And for a society to work, if everybody told the truth, you know, if we didn't have to worry about somebody stealing my password and
right.
robbing my bank account, and if companies didn't have to worry about people stealing things from them, if we could trust people, what a wonderful society that would be. And God laid out, here's how a society should work. That's
right.
The way it works best. Not coveting. Don't go around resenting other people who have more than you do. Just be content with what you have. And if you go through, those are kind of the hardcore skeleton of faith. But then you get to the New Testament, and Jesus says, you can actually sum up the entire Ten Commandments in this: love God and love your neighbor as yourself. So it's the internal skeleton of faith. On the outside, you don't see the skeleton, but it makes possible the love that we're supposed to give in the world.
I mean, that is really, again, I think nature screams, God is there.
Yeah.
And that's what you're uncovering. As I understand it, we have about 35 trillion blood cells in our body, but we don't think much about the cells in our body until we start maybe losing them at a drastic rate or whatever, however they get out of kilter, from a bloody nose to some kind of a cut where the platelets do their job to block that cut. For those of us who don't remember their biology class, explain how our blood is also such a spiritual dimension.
There's a lot of blood in the Bible, a lot of uses of the word blood. And one of the most interesting and new thoughts to me that I heard from Dr. Brand was, we tend to think of the communion service as a time to commemorate death, because we reflect back on Jesus' death. He said, actually, if you look at the Bible, all the way through the Old Testament especially, blood stands for life. The life of the flesh is in the blood, it says in Leviticus. And when Jesus gave the instructions at the Last Supper, he used the image of the vine and the branches. And he said, you need to be connected to me. If you're connected to the vine, then you can produce fruit. If you're not connected, it's like these branches up there that just shrivel and die. They're no longer connected. And that blood is really a symbol of God's life flowing through us. We are participating in that. He also goes on to say, blood cleanses. And when I first heard that, I thought, how does blood cleanse? When I get blood, I want to immediately find some spot cleaner and Tide and clean it off my clothes. He said, no, here's how blood cleanses. As it goes through your body, not only is it providing oxygen and nutrients and things like that, but every one of your cells is producing this waste material, and the blood cells that are going through, those trillions you mentioned, the blood cells are taking a cargo load of those toxic chemicals.
Of waste
and getting rid of them. And he said, you can figure that out very quickly. Take a blood pressure cuff, put it around your arm, and make it tight. And for a while there, you don't feel anything. But after a few minutes, you feel excruciating pain. Why? Because you've blocked the blood from going down into the rest of your arm and taking away those toxic chemicals.
Mm.
And blood is a cleansing agent. And so Dr. Brand, who is a medical doctor, found ways that I would never have thought of that show the spiritual parallel, how blood is the living connection to the source of life. And then blood is also a cleansing agent.
And I think you're aiming in this direction, but I want to be very specific. In the book, you speak to the issue of communion,
mm-hmm.
that the bread represents the body of Christ, and the the juice represents the blood of Christ. Speak at the end here, and we're going to come back if you'll stick with us and talk more about the subject.
Sure.
But let's end on this good note of what it means, the communion service, and what it's getting at. It's a tough one to convey to people that don't get it.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't even understand, like, why are you pretending to eat Jesus' body? Mm-hmm. And why are you pretending to drink his blood? It's grape juice. So I want to get it down to a very elementary level here. Give us the communion theology.
Yeah. I think it's intentional that Jesus chose two of the most common elements of the day, bread. Bread is everywhere, every culture. And then wine in those days, and said, these can stand for, these can symbolize the life that I have that will energize you. In fact, he kind of scandalized followers in his day when he said, eat my flesh, drink my blood. He didn't mean literally, obviously, because he's standing there as a complete human being. But what he said was, the most basic, ordinary things in life can be a symbol that reminds you that your strength comes not from yourself, but from something outside, and you can take it into yourself, and you can metabolize that, and that can give you energy and cleansing from sin, very clearly, and then the nutrient that you need to be part of me, to live like me.
Mm. I mean, that is so good, and I hope you're catching that, and your book, Fearfully and Wonderfully, The Marvel of Bearing God's Image. This is fascinating stuff. It's a great read. And Dr. Mm-hmm. Paul Brand, who's passed away now, who was with Jesus in heaven. And what an amazing way to provide those insights in the physical nature and how it shows the spiritual nature of who we are made in his image. Mm-hmm. And Philip, I hope, like I said, we can stick with it and continue to talk about the content. Can we do that?
Let's do it.
All right. Very good. Listen, we often do this, but if you can make a gift of any amount, we'll send you a copy of Philip's book as our way of saying thank you for joining in ministry. You can do that on a monthly basis, which is terrific, mm-hmm. or a one-time gift is fine as well. But even if you can't afford it, the content is so rich and so meaningful. If you can't afford it, just get a hold of us. We'll send you the book and trust others will cover the cost of that. It's that critical. This is one of those resources you really want to have for yourself and to share with others.
Mm-hmm. We'd love to hear from you. If you have questions about what we've talked about today, if you'd like this terrific resource, Fearfully and Wonderfully, The Marvel of Bearing God's Image, just get in touch with us. Our number is 800, the letter A, and the word family. Or click the link on your screen. And on behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back as we once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.